Hello, good evening, and welcome to another edition of the Paranormal Peep Show with myself, Neil Geddes Ward, and Andrew Chaplin. Hi, Andy, how are you?
Hi, folks. Thanks for listening and joining in. We've got a wonderful guest this evening.
Yeah, Andy, would you do the honours of introducing our guest for tonight?
I can indeed. This is a man very familiar to yourself and myself who often goes to the High Wycombe paranormal meetup, Ben Emlyn-Jones, and he used to be a hospital porter. Which hospital was it, Ben? Remind me.
John Radcliffe in Oxford.
John Radcliffe in Oxford. Excellent, excellent. And Ben, I understand you're going to be talking about some of the incidents, I suppose you could call, surrounding Helen Duncan and the whole controversy there, and also some of the sceptics' point of view as well.
Yeah, I'll try. We'll cover as much as we can. I'm sure we can get through a lot of that. Yeah.
Cool. Okay, thanks, Andy. So, Ben, yeah, if we could just have a little bit of a background about you. As Andy said, that you were formerly a hospital porter, you also present your own radio show as well. So could you give listeners who don't know much about you a brief kind of introduction to yourself and your work?
Well, I do. My website is called HPANWO, Hospital Porters Against the New World Order, and it's very much a multimedia thing. I have, like you said, I have my own radio show. I also do YouTube videos. I write fiction, and some of my fiction is published on one of my websites. And I write. I have a new site which I try to update as often as possible, every day if I can.
And, you want to give us the quick URL of the websites that you've got?
Yes, HPANWO. I pronounce it Hapanwo. HPANWO.blogspot.com. That's the main site. It's also the portal to all the other sites.
Fantastic. And we're actually going to go into the second half as to why it's called the Hospital Porters specifically, because a lot of people will be wondering what the Hospital Porters bit is against the New World Order. So certainly the second half we'll cover that. And the first half, we're going to be talking about Helen Duncan.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so Ben, obviously you've done talks for the High Wycombe Paranormal Group, which I run in High Wycombe in Bucks in the UK, and Andy comes along, and you yourself have come along and done interviews for us on video, but also you've done a few talks on zombies and things like that. Now, you've also done a presentation on Helen Duncan. Now, can you, obviously, let's talk about her. Who was Helen Duncan?
Yeah, this lady called Helen Duncan is actually, I think, one of the most interesting people I've ever come across. Now, she was born in Callander in Scotland in 1897. And in 1944, she became the last person ever to be imprisoned under the Witchcraft Act of 1735. This was a very archaic law. It's one of these laws that was created in the time of the Enlightenment, which basically was... I can't remember the full text of it, but it was who pretend the conjuration of spirits and things like that, those who prevent using clever trickery and things like that. It's basically to keep fake mediums in line.
Mm.
I think
it was something along the lines of not using tools to conjure spirits or something of that.
Yeah, basically it was one of the world's first skeptic laws. However, by the 20th century, it was pretty much. It was pretty much just one of these sort of like vestigial laws that was only on the statute books because nobody could bother to get enough MPs together to officially repeal it. Mm-hmm. So it hadn't been used hardly at all actually since the middle of the previous century. Yet the government actually got out this archaic law. They dusted it off and they used it to prosecute this this lady Helen Duncan. She was what you call a medium. A psychic medium, someone who channels the spirits of the deceased.
And was she doing that all her life?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, she, from a very young age, ever since she was a little girl, she had what you might call psychic experiences. She was nicknamed Hellish Nell when she was a little girl because of her various... it had more to do with her personality, actually, than her abilities, but she was quite fiery and quite volatile, shall we say. But... she also had the ability to perceive things. She actually managed to use what would today be called remote viewing. And this came in very handy at one point because who lived in a local community once got lost in a very, very bitter winter storm. And the search party actually took Helen with them. She was only about 5 years old at the time. But they took her with them because they she could actually guide them to, she said she could guide them to where the man was. So even at a very young age, this her skill was well known to the local people, and I think they respected her because they did manage to find this man. They managed to find this man before he died, because he would have died of cold if he hadn't been found.
So did she locate him with what you say is like homing in on him in the traditional kind of mediumistic way? Was she asking spirits, or was she doing a remote viewing technique, do you think, to locate him?
I'm not sure what it was. This is from a very interesting book that I read on Helen, and it said that it explained basically a bit of her background. She also had she used to write when she was at school and she couldn't answer a question, she used to put the school book under her chair, and she'd put it out later and someone had written in the answers. That's another anecdote from her early life.
So if someone else had written in the answers physically in a book, that's a very mysterious phenomenon there.
Yes, extremely.
It's almost like physical materialization or physical mediumship to a certain extent, but it's actually happening in the classroom of a school, not in a darkened room or blacked out room or anything like that. It's very, very, very kind of unique individual there.
She was actually part of this very, very unique and exclusive class of psychic medium, which, as you say, are materialization mediums. They're physical.
Sorry, Ben, did she have a spiritualist background or any kind of like circle training, development training, or was it kind of like a natural thing that she just kind of flowed with?
I don't know. I mean, based on the early age which she demonstrated these abilities, I'd say it was something natural. I don't know whether she had any proper development or not.
Mm. Do you know if she had any contact with... actually, funny enough, when were the Fox sisters? That was earlier, wasn't it?
That was a long time earlier. That was in the 1840s, I believe, in the United States. Interesting thing about the Fox sisters, I mean, if you ask the skeptics, they'll tell you that the Fox sisters actually confessed to having faked their everything they did. However, there's reason to believe that their confession was actually insincere, and it was made because they couldn't tolerate what they were doing. They couldn't cope with the lifestyle they were living anymore, so they wanted to get out of it.
Yeah.
But Helen actually did actually as she grew older, I mean, whether she went to a development circle or not, she began to practice as a full-time psychic spiritualist medium. By the 1920s, she was established in that respect. And she made a healthy living, which I think is fair enough. I mean, her husband was very ill. He couldn't work. She had 8 children. So this was basically the only way she could avoid bringing them up in poverty. She did practice. She became very famous. She traveled the country. I mean, I don't know if she ever went abroad, but she became very, very well known. And this obviously drew the attention of the psychical research community. And this is where she was actually invited to London to take part in a psychical research project. And the London Spiritualist Alliance, which today is called the London College of Psychic Studies, it changed its name. They actually they actually had her in the laboratories, and they were doing tests on her. It all fell apart, though, because it was a very complicated situation in which the skeptics again misrepresented. They claim that the skeptics claim that Helen Duncan failed the tests that she was put under, and that she was not actually materializing any ectoplasm. She was actually materializing cheesecloth. But there's several reasons to doubt that. Firstly, Helen signed an exclusivity contract for the London Spiritualist Alliance when she arrived. There'd been a bidding process. And there's a guy called Harry Price, who was a lone maverick in the field. And he had put in a bid to actually have Helen Duncan in his laboratory, and he'd lost to the LSA. I don't know exactly what the rules were, but Helen was the exclusive property of the concern of the LSA. However, Price contacted her secretly and asked him to do some experiments in his laboratory as well, and not to tell the LSA. Hmm. So Helen actually broke this exclusivity contract. I think she probably didn't quite understand what she was getting involved in, and didn't really understand the seriousness of the issue. But there was a big fight over it. There was a big row that was generated from this. Between Price and the LSA, and Helen was caught in the middle of it, and she walked out of the process, the whole experiment of both organisations. So the studies were basically not completed.
Surprise, he was involved in Bawley Rectory, I believe. Was that the reason?
Yeah, he was some quite well known. He was quite well known through the in that era. He died in 1948, but he was before then. He was very. He got the impression of being a believer in the paranormal, but essentially a debunker. So he was in a position that he accepted that some paranormal phenomena were real, but he spent most of his time focusing on what he would consider solved cases or easy to solve cases. So it became a. And there are some characters like that today, actually, I could mention, who are quite similar, who have a similar attitude. And I sometimes think they'd. Someone say, well, I wish they'd focus on the cases which were they couldn't solve rather than those they could. But it appears that the. Both the LSA and Price were felt a bit humiliated by Helen and her and various what she was doing. So there's a kind of rush to the line to publish first a paper denouncing her as a fraud. But so the actual story of what so Price for Harry Price, and instantly he has a website which you can go look at today, harrypricedot.com. He didn't set that up himself because, as I said, he died in 1948. One of his fans did. But you can read his paper on Helen Duncan. And it's really quite remarkable because he said that she had actually. There's some photographs of Helen in trance, exuding ectoplasm. Ectoplasm is this material that physical mediums are said to issue from the body. It sometimes comes from the mouth or nose or even from underneath the fingernails, which forms into shapes which are recognizable as spirits. This is this is what a materialization medium does. There are apparently only 6 materialization mediums in the world today. It's that rare. And you won't find them down your local spiritualist church very often. But what Price said Helen was doing was, she's swallowing cheesecloth. She swallows a massive piece of cheesecloth and then holds it in her stomach and then regurgitates it. She throws it up and makes it look like a spirit, like ectoplasm, because she was searched from head to foot. Helen was stripped naked. There was a female nurse called Mary McGinley who actually poked and prodded her in every part of her body from head to toe to check she wasn't hiding anything in her person. And so she said, but they didn't check her stomach. So Price actually demanded that she was x-rayed and she refused to be x-rayed. But that's not the reason she refused to be x-rayed, because she was basically in a temper with Price. But the fact of the matter is, it takes an awful lot of... it takes a very, very broad imagination to conclude this was happening, especially when Price actually only produced a small amount of this cheesecloth. He said it was cheesecloth and rubber gloves and tissue paper and egg white. That's what she said this was. That Helen had swallowed, held in her stomach, and then regurgitated in the laboratory to produce this effect. You think he'd manage to get a bigger bit of it, first of all, not just a little piece of it. Secondly,
and I would say if they're so keen on this concept and they think this is how it's done, why can't they find someone to reproduce it? Why can't they, in a scientific manner, try and do exactly what they've just said?
It's quite a feat, isn't it, to think that you could take a piece of textile which is about 6 foot square, swallow it, hold it in your stomach, bring it up, throw it up, like vomit it, and then swallow it again without using your hands and without making a big mess everywhere. Because, what you know, how could she regurgitate this cheesecloth and not this morning's breakfast?
And without the retching noise that you would definitely hear. You would definitely hear a retching noise.
Also produce it into a facsimile of a human being as well.
Yeah.
With her hands strapped to a chair.
Yeah. And there's a guy called Will Goldston, who was chairman of the Magic Circle at the time. And he actually hosted Helen Duncan at his own premises, his own home, which is also in London, at around the same time, which is 1930. And this all happened in 1930. And he said something very differently. He said that he's a magician. He knows about fake mediums because he's encountered them. And he said he checked her, he tied her up, and he made sure she was very, very well bound and everything. And he observed what she was doing. And he said quite clearly, she's not using any of this trickery. She actually consumed a cup of coffee and some tea cakes while he was with her. And there's no way, he said, how could she have done this and then held this stuff in her stomach? It doesn't make sense. I mean, one of the skeptics said she's got a double stomach. Well, I mean, it's very you see, I mean, I don't know if that's possible in humans. I know cows have multiple stomachs, but actually she had x-rays taken of her at a later date, which showed she has a perfectly normal stomach. just like anybody else.
What I find absolutely gobsmacking is that supposed scientific, rational-minded people were coming up with theories that are just wacky, crazy, just insane theories, and then taking them seriously. I mean, what the hell?
Well, this is something we can talk about later when I bring up the skeptic subject in greater detail. But, I mean, there's this kind of idea that non-paranormal, otherwise they use the word mundane, or even a rational explanation. Which a rational explanation is in itself a misnomer. If they say rational explanation, they're essentially tipping their hand, because an explanation can never be rational, only a method can. You can have an explanation which comes from rational process, a rational method, or an irrational method. But the moment you start saying, well, the explanation is rational, you're essentially saying it's one that skeptics like. It's an explanation that skeptics like. And they say things like, well, we have to consider non-paranormal phenomena first before we all non-paranormal possibilities, any physically possible non-paranormal possibility, before we consider paranormal possibilities. And there's no real explanation about why that is a moral imperative to begin with. Why do you have to do that? Because then the moment you start saying, well, anything physically possible could explain that, debunking, you really get into the area where explaining away something paranormal becomes essentially an exercise of the imagination. I could say, for instance, the Rendlesham Forest incident of 1980, which was a UFO encounter. People are saying, well, it was, they just, the witnesses just saw a lighthouse. It wasn't a UFO, it was just a lighthouse. And we could say, well, how do you know that when they didn't describe anything that looks like a lighthouse? And you can answer, well, a lighthouse is a non extraterrestrial explanation, and I thought of it. So you see what I mean? It's this is one of the fallacies of the skeptic movement.
And one of the problems is, of course, is the very term paranormal is entirely subjective. So let's say ghosts exist. Well, it's normal within the realms of kind of like the ghostly world, or among mediums, among the psychics and the mediums community. If they see a ghost, that is normal to them from their perspective. It's only paranormal to people who have not seen ghosts and are not in that community. Everything's kind of, it's a perception.
Well, the phrase paranormal, it simply means things we don't understand, phenomena we don't yet understand. You go back a few centuries and lightning was paranormal.
Yeah, exactly.
And there was a time when bats were considered to have paranormal abilities to navigate in the dark. It turns out that they were using echolocation for sound. So paranormal is just one of these things. I mean, it's possible that we may one day find out exactly what UFOs, ghosts, other things like that are. And we explain them within the realms of our own ability to understand, but we're not at that point yet.
So Ben, let's kind of like maybe drift back onto Helen Duncan and kind of connect that to the Second World War and how it began. So let's kind of like go on to maybe 1939, the beginning of the war, and what she was up to then.
Yes, that's right. Helen continued to practice after this ill-fated psychological experiment that was a psychical research experiment that was done in 1930. And she had a few run-ins with a few people. She was in court at one point and fined 10 shillings for supposedly being a fake medium. Now, in 1939, World War II broke out. And her business boomed. She became very, very well, very, very much needed, because, of course, we were losing people, especially in the first part of the war. We lost a lot of soldiers. And also the Blitz was in full swing, which meant that in the end, 60,000 people, I think, died in the Blitz. And people were spending night times in their air raid shelters in the garden and things like that. They were carrying gas masks around with them, things like that. So Helen was very much required, and she travelled in many, many, many places. And one of those places was called the Master Temple in Portsmouth. And this is actually, despite its grandiose name, it's actually just a little room above a chemist shop. Today it's a jewelry shop. I've actually been there, and it's just someone lives there. It's a flat. Mm-hmm. It's a lounge in the flat, you know. And so Helen visited the Master Temple many times. It was run by Mr. and Mrs. Homer, the couple that ran the chemist shop. And now in 1941, something remarkable happened. She was in the Master Temple doing a seance, and Albert, her Albert. Albert is the name of her spirit guide. And this was a man who, in his previous incarnation in a physical body, had lived in Australia and had died around about 1900. And he's a tall man with a strong Australian accent. And he came through and he announced to the audience who were in the temple, in the Master Temple, I'm very sorry to have to tell you that a British battleship has just been sunk. I have 1,400 of her officers and men newly arrived in the spirit world with me. And there's a big gasp in the audience. What do you mean a British battleship's just been sunk? And fatefully, one of the people in the audience was a man called Brigadier Roy Firebrace. Now, he was head of Army Intelligence for Scotland. And he was also very keen on psychical research. He was a member of the Society for Psychical Research. He was a spiritualist. He was an occultist. He knew Aleister Crowley. And so he was very, very concerned about this. So, but he this is why he attended seances like this. But he went back to his office and he got on the secure phone to the Admiralty in London. He said, excuse me, I just had you wouldn't believe this. I've just heard a psychic medium talking about a British battleship being sunk. Is that true? And they said, oh, no, it's not true, sir. It must be a mistake. So he breathed a sigh of relief and put the phone down. Anyway, a few hours later, this same person called him back to actually issue a correction. I'm sorry, we have actually lost a battleship. We've lost HMS Hood. She was sunk in a battle in the North Sea with Prince Eugen, which is a big German battleship, and went down with 1,400 hands. And Firebrace was astonished. I mean, he knew immediately what this involved. He knew that basically Helen Duncan was giving away information about the war, which was not through the mainstream media sources. Now, this meant she could give away classified information. If she did that, would mean she represented an unpluggable leak. I mean, you know the phrase, we had to kill him because he knew too much. It's a cliche in spy thrillers, books and films. But what do you do when you can't silence someone even by killing them? So it was he must have been very, very worried about this. And you could bet that somebody kept a very close eye on Helen Duncan. And we know almost certainly that's the case for various reasons, including a letter which is still in the possession of Firebrace's daughter, who's still alive, in which he writes to the head of intelligence at that time, specifically recommending that Helen Duncan be watched. And it got worse because in November of that same year, 1941, Helen was back at the Master Temple, and Albert came forward and he said, I'm very sorry, but we've lost another British battleship. I have 700 of our officers and men newly arrived from the spirit world. And one of these guys appeared, one of the sailors. He actually appeared in spirit, in ectoplasm, dressed in his uniform, his little square rig with a little cap, which is HMS on it. And one of the sitters was his mother and recognised him and broke down in tears. Now, what happened in this case was very, very worrying for the government because, from their point of view, because they actually had decided to keep this secret, but a ship had sunk. It was actually HMS Barham, an Admiral-class battlecruiser, very similar to Hood. And it was one of the most powerful warships the Royal Navy possessed, actually, a major surface combatant. And she'd gone down in the Mediterranean, sunk by a U-boat, and her loss was a major blow to the war effort. And this came at a time just after Dunkirk, when the Blitz was in full swing, and no one knew how the war was going to go. I mean, we know it because we see it through retrospect, through history, but at the time, people was in the middle of it. No one knew what was going to happen. So the government, to keep morale up on the home front, they decided to keep the sinking of HMS Barham secret. And even some of the relatives of the deceased had not been told. Some of them had been sent memos just saying, look, just don't tell anyone. Secret courier-delivered messages, which they had to, which they couldn't keep. They had to destroy them afterwards. So basically, very few people knew about it, and it was only the following year it was revealed officially in the news. Now, for whatever reason, they decided to let Helen Duncan go on practicing, and they didn't pull her in straight away. They just let her carry on, but they must have been watching her. Now, go forward a few years, January 1944. Helen Duncan is doing another seance at the Master Temple, and there's a police raid, and she's arrested. and she was charged with under the 1735 Witchcraft Act. If found guilty, she could find herself in jail for 9 months. And she was not tried at the local. She was expecting to be dragged to the local magistrate's court, given a fine, whatever, and let go under the Vagrancy Act, which is the legislation that was normally used. But instead, this trial was held at the Old Bailey at the Central Criminal Court in London. And she couldn't. She must have been absolutely out of her depth. She must have been absolutely horrified and confused over what was happening. And so, basically, they took her there and they gave her a trial, and she was found guilty.
And now the prosecution must have come up with reasons why, or at least how she got the information. I mean, from memory, I think the government took the position, or the prosecution took the position, that she was a German enemy agent, that she was working for the Nazis. But then that raises the question, well, why on earth is she doing seances, talking about all these ships sinking? And, you know, how does that play into the hands of Hitler?
Well, if she had been working for the other side, she'd get a lot more. She'd be taken a lot more seriously, because the Nazis took the paranormal very seriously. They used remote viewers and psychics of their own, including this medium called Sylvia Ortich, who was used by the SS to spy on the enemy. But the government officially was a very sceptic government in Britain, officially. But I mean, talking about the prosecution is very interesting. I mean, they obviously they were worried, because they knew that our intelligence organisations were watching it. There was a unit called B-19 was probably just deployed to keep an eye on her, because this was a wartime unit, a division of MI5, which was used to track sources of rumours. It's human intelligence, and So I think they were watching. They must have been keeping an eye on, and they must have known that if their side were watching them, you could bet the enemy was as well, because the word would have got around. Now, in the prosecution was very interesting, because the chief prosecution barrister was a guy called John Cyril Maud KC, who was a very, very experienced barrister. He's one of the best in the country, which is why the Crown would have wanted that as their prosecution counsel. But what's most interesting about Elam is that he had an assistant called Henry Elam. Yeah. What's interesting about Maud is that he was head of Section B-19 for MI5. In the war, most people had more than one job, and very often they were involved in the war effort, even if they had a day job, which they normally did. Now, there was another chap involved. The chief prosecution witness was called West, Arthur West, Lieutenant, no, sorry, what was his name? Oh, it's PC Rupert Cross, and I can't remember I'll come back to that in a moment. But the what's interesting is there's some documents been uncovered to indicate that Maud was actually reporting to someone called Commander Ian Fleming, who was the Deputy Director of Naval Intelligence at that time, and one of the most experienced intelligence agents in the country. Spied on the Moscow show trials. He also spied on the Spanish Civil War. And he was into psychical research. He knew Aleister Crowley. He was a member. He knew Brigadier Roy Firebrace. And he knew several other people he knew Harry Price. So he was very much on Firebrace's level. So Fleming and Firebrace were very much on the same level, and they must have conferred behind the scenes. Does the name Ian Fleming sound familiar to you? Yeah. He created the James Bond novels. He created James Bond. And, he created the James Bond novel, which, of course, spawned a very, very, an extremely successful film franchise.
And in actual fact, he used the code name for Bond as 007, which was actually, I believe, Elizabeth I's, one of her spies, way, way back in, 1500s, 1600s?
That's right, yes. That's absolutely right. He did indeed. This is, I should get my notes out. Sorry about this. I should remember these things, but when I'm on the radio, I sometimes have trouble. But
wasn't one of the spies of Elizabeth I, whether it's the same chap or not, wasn't he also a psychic or a medium or an astrologer or something? Or John Dee?
I think it's John Dee, and I think he used to sign his name as 007.
Yeah.
And obviously Fleming got hold of that and kind of like used that for Bond.
So Fleming was very much of a almost like a secret occultist, you could say, perhaps, which...
Well, there was a strange kind of like paradox within the medieval times and beyond, because although things like that, like psychics and mediums and things, were very much condemned and you could be hung as a witch and burnt at the stake and all that kind of thing, but in the very upper echelons, the very kind of like elitist levels, it seemed to be kind of okay. They did actually have their astrologers, they did actually have their kind of their fortune tellers, but for some reason the lower masses, if they started dabbling in it, then they would be up for witch hunts. Trials and all sorts.
I think nothing's changed, to be honest. Yeah. But you know what they're doing in society today, aren't they?
Yeah. You know, the funny thing about Fleming is, well, one of the James Bond films, I mean, I've never read any of the books, but one of the James Bond films is called Live and Let Die.
Oh, yes.
And it is centered around voodoo and tarot, and it has the chief bad guy is like this voodoo priest. He has this like priestess with who does tarot cards.
Baron Samedi.
Yeah, it's a very, very good, film indeed. One of the best ones. Now, the chief prosecution witness was called, it back to Helen Duncan again, was a guy called Lieutenant Stanley Raymond Worth. Now, Worth is very interesting because he lied under oath, because the defence counsel, a guy called I can't remember these names.
It's Helen Duncan coming through from the other side.
What's his name? I've been talking about this non-stop, and suddenly I've forgotten his name. Losby. Charles Losby, the defence counsel. He said, are you a member of the intelligence services? He asked him, and he cross-examined Worth. Worth said, no, sir, I'm not. But he lied. He was a member of the Special Investigation Division of the Navy Provost. So he's the kind of guy who would have been employed to keep an eye on Helen. I mean, and be reporting to Maud and reporting to Fleming. And he was assisted by another policeman called PC Rupert Cross, and they were actually in the audience. This is how the raid on January the 19th, 1944, this is how it was organised. Basically, Worth and Cross were in the audience and pretending to be just normal sitters dressed in plain clothes. And they were outside. There was some police hiding. And basically, at the right moment, Worth stood up, switched on a torch. They had torches with them, and they blew a whistle. And the police just burst in a matter of moments. They were up the stairs and out through the chemist shop, up the stairs, and into the seance room, and arrested Helen. They detained everyone there. So now Worth, it was very funny because Worth said he did it for fun. He used to go to seances. He didn't believe any of it, but he was just a bit of a laugh. He called it going to the spooks. He and his friends, you know, it would be like a lad's night out. We're not going to go to the pub tonight, lads. Let's go to the spooks. And which is odd because it's quite expensive. It cost 12 shillings, which was a lot of money in those days. But they used to go to the spooks. Didn't say how he could afford it in wartime, but that's what he did. And he said when he realised that Helen Duncan was a fraud, because he saw Helen Duncan prancing around covered in this sheet, this white, big white sheet. It must have been a big sheet, because if you see pictures of Helen Duncan, you'll see she's no ballerina. She's a big lady. So big, big, huge sheet. And said, oh, she's fake. So I'm going to bring her to justice. It's my duty. And he told Losby that he was spying on his own account, whatever the hell that means. But that's what he said to her. He said he decided to do it completely personal motives. And he contacted the police, he told them, and he organised the raid. With Chief Constable Arthur West, who was head of the police in Portsmouth, he was a personal family friend of Worth. And Worth also knew the leader of the police raid. So the whole prosecution side of this trial is starting to look like some kind of secret cabal. And the judge as well was the Recorder of London, Sir Gerald Dodson. Now, he was very sentimental about anything to do with the Royal Navy, because he was involved with Royal Navy charities. So, so it's very, very... it sounds to me dodgy as hell, basically.
A little bit of a stitch-up job to me.
Yes, dodgy as hell, I would say.
Was there a reason for legitimately placing the trial to the Old Bailey, a very high-profile kind of court?
Absolutely none. In fact, Winston Churchill wrote to the... He wrote to the Home Secretary at one point, and he said, let me have a report on your convenience why the Witchcraft Act of 1735 was And he goes on to say... let me just find the actual quote. Let me have a report on why the Witchcraft Act of 1735 was used in a modern court of justice. What was the cost of this trial to the state? Observing that witnesses were brought from Portsmouth and maintained here in this crowded London for a fortnight, and the recorder kept busy with all this obsolete tomfoolery to the detriment of the necessary work to the courts. And this was completely irregular. I mean, Churchill, we know Churchill was a believer in spiritualism, but I mean, he was not even in the loop. He didn't even know this was going on. he first found out about it when he read about it in the papers. And he was prime minister. So it sounds very, very dodgy indeed. It's like a very, very large sledgehammer is being used to crack a very small nut. There must have been an ulterior motive. I know what it is.
It's almost like they're trying to make an example of her to say to other people, if there are mediums out there or however you're getting this information, shut up and don't say anything because it's going to jeopardize the war effort.
Yeah,
well, yeah, they had a real serious motive here because, of course, Helen was found guilty. She was on the 20th of March. Basically, it was all over because the jury went out. They considered their verdict. It only took half an hour. She was guilty. And the Chief Constable Arthur West, him again, gave Helen such a damning character assessment that the judge had no choice. He had to sentence her for the maximum of 9 months in jail. And she was taken to Holloway Prison, a women's prison in London, and kept there. I mean, she got a bit of time knocked off because she'd been refused bail. She'd been held on remand. And so she got a bit of time knocked off for that. But why should be held under bail? I mean, you know, what danger would she be to society? But she wasn't released until September. But on the 6th of June 1944, what happened? Do you remember? Operation Overlord, the mass amphibious landing of Normandy, France. And history comes to know it as D-Day. Now, D-Day was planned a long time in advance, and Fleming was involved in it. Commander Ian Fleming was actually involved in the disinformation operation to make the Germans and think that the Allies were going to invade through Italy. He even created fake documents and planted them on a dead body to be found by the enemy.
Yeah, this was a tramp, wasn't it? I believe it was either Crete or Spain, I think, that the body was found.
But basically, he was put in an RAF uniform and dropped from a plane to make them think it was a pilot who'd been killed in an aircraft crash.
Yeah, yeah.
And the parachute in the sea. The enemy found the body. This document was on it, and they believed it. But what happened was, I mean, there was so much secrecy. I mean, it was what I would call a top-heavy conspiracy. Many, many people were briefed in. There's even a fake village in Somerset they built, and you can go and visit it. It's a museum today. It would only take one person to die, who was briefed in, and for that person to come through in one of Helen's seances, and for an enemy agent to be in the room, and the secret is blown. And there's more than one person died, because this is new information. This is new information that's come about since I did the recording with you, Neil, at the High Wycombe Paranormal Group.
Oh, right.
Okay. In November of 1943, a ship, one of those landing ships, those infantry landing vessels with the big drawbridge at the front, over the bows.
Like an amphibious landing thing with wheels and stuff, yeah.
You've seen them on the movies where they land on the beach and the troops come out. One of those
landing craft, yeah.
Yeah. It was exercising off the coast of Dorset, and it sunk. I think all the people, it was fully loaded with troops, and they all drowned. So there was a good couple of hundred guys floating around in the Altons, waiting for a chance to come through, who knew about D-Day. And the government, all they had to do was they had to shut Helen up. They had to get her off the spiritualist scene just until D-Day.
It almost seems like the government were forced to believe in a weird way. Because if they discounted the fact that she was a German spy, and I don't know if they went with that or not, or truly believed that or not, if the only other option was she was getting this psychically, it's almost like they're forced to accept that she is, in fact, a medium and it is coming from some etheric world.
Yeah, it's honestly, even if... I might personally believe that she was a... I personally think she was actually a real psychic medium, but I mean, whether she was or not is kind of a separate issue to the fact that many, many people in very high positions in the wartime Britain thought she was. They took her seriously.
Yeah, yeah, they did.
The interesting thing that comes to mind is that why didn't they? And this is probably why, probably because it would have proved too much of a hot potato, perhaps, in a court of law, that she was allowed to demonstrate her mediumistic abilities.
Well, this is what she wanted to do. This is what she wanted to do. She wanted to actually perform in court. This is what I suppose is a mistake that Loseby made, because, I mean, Loseby didn't actually cross-examine the witnesses at the Crown's witnesses enough, because he wanted to wait for the next part of the trial, where he hoped to get all the charges against Helen Duncan dropped in one foul swoop. Through some incredible thing, he would actually have Helen perform a live seance in court. He said, he actually said this. He said, if Mrs. Duncan is a materialization medium, then there is a spirit world near her at this moment, and a guide right here, possibly waiting for an opportunity to help her. Let us call him. Yes, here, in the Central Criminal Court of London. Why not? She requires a curtained-off partition and a red light. Nothing more. This is the acid test to which she should be willing to subject herself. I tell you this much. She is so willing. The judge refused point blank. He said no. He said he wouldn't do it. Loseby appealed, and they polled the jury, and the jury voted not to see the seance in the courtroom. I mean, WTF? I mean, this is unbelievable. I mean, if you were on that jury, just for your own personal curiosity, wouldn't you want to witness something like that?
I think that'd be amazing.
I would have been so gutted if I was on that jury and they all voted not to. I would have been so peed off with them.
It sounds completely unbelievable that they wouldn't allow that. I mean, firstly, I mean, I can't remember, what was it? I think it was old Dodson said, spiritualism is not on trial here. Mrs. Duncan is. So basically, this was just a technicality, saying, well, basically, it doesn't matter if she's capable of spiritualism. The fact is, she didn't perform real spiritualism on the 19th of January, 1944. But, I mean, that's a ridiculous excuse, because, let's face it, I mean, if she had performed and succeeded, then the prosecution would have to explain why someone with her abilities would need to fake things.
Yeah.
So basically, the prosecution case would have fallen apart if Helen had performed in court. And so that was it. The trial proceeded, and Helen was found guilty. I mean, there's all kinds of weird things. I mean, firstly, Worth should have been prosecuted for perjury, for lying under oath, because he said he wasn't in the intelligence services when he was.
When was that found out, though? Later on, many years later?
It was found later, yeah, it was found out later on. But he should have been prosecuted for that. But he buggered off to New Zealand. I mean, he died actually in the late 90s, and he'd been living in New Zealand. And he was interviewed for a TV documentary in the 90s, and he stood by his story to his day. But it's really weird, because, like, there's all kinds of weird things. Like, he and Cross, his accomplice in the audience, they said, Helen Duncan is using a white... She's covering herself with this white bedsheet to make herself look like a ghost. Right. And so when they blew the whistle and switched the torches on in the Martyr Temple, Cross and Worth ran forward and they grabbed this fake ectoplasm. They grabbed this bedsheet while the police were coming in. Right. So this bedsheet really should have been a major court exhibit, wouldn't it? I mean, it's a vital piece of physical evidence. So where was it?
Vanished.
It's lunacy. The excuses they gave, oh, someone must have hidden it. We sort of lost our grip on it, and someone must have hidden it. Let's get it straight. The lights switched on. The police were bursting in the chaos of a police raid. They both got their hands on this piece of fake ectoplasm, and somehow they lose it, and the police don't find. I mean, it's.
I mean, that should be Exhibit A, surely.
Yeah, of course. This is a bedsheet big enough to cover a 20-stone woman. And they lose it. I mean, this is just, it's so obvious that this is fake. This is a complete and utter fabrication. So, there was no bedsheet.
For the benefit of listeners who don't understand the ramifications of why physical mediums use a darkened seance room with a red light and why they're behind a cabinet, can you go into the kind of logistics of why all that happens, Ben?
Yeah, sure. Well, what happens is that the procedure for Helen's mediumship and for physical mediumship is very, very simple. I mean, it's simple in most cases, but Helen's was more complicated. And she actually got the idea to make her own seance procedures more complicated from her experience in 1930 in Harry Price's laboratory. After that, she changed her style to include some new additional precautions. What Helen wanted to do, she was absolutely... very, very important. She felt it was very, very important that people believed her, that believed she was genuine. So she would, what happened was the medium would go into the, would actually change into a different clothing. They would actually change clothing to prove. Helen would, this is what Helen did. She would take off her clothes and put on a black, simple black dress, which was tied up with actual string. It wasn't buttons, it was actually tied with string. So make sure she was actually, she was kind of sewn into this dress. But before she was actually, before she actually put on this dress, she actually got, she employed a nurse called Molly Goldney. Now, you think to yourself, who would actually search her the way that Mary McGinley had done in Price's laboratory. And it was actually, would poke and prod her from head to toe to make sure she wasn't hiding anything anywhere on her body. Because this was common, this is a trick that fake mediums used to use in those days. Now, you think, well, this is the employee of Helen. I mean, you, how can you trust her? Well, you can trust her because she invited female members of the audience to come and watch this being done. This Helen was actually willing to put herself through this indignity of having total strangers watching her stripped down to a birthing suit and being poked and prodded by this nurse because she wanted them to believe that she was real. She wanted to show them that she was not hiding any props on her body. And then she'd go into the seance room. Now, the seance room, it consisted of a row of spectator seats, which was usually just set up. They were often, some of these spiritualist centers were actually normal rooms and they were used for normal purposes and they were converted into spiritualist centers just for the purposes of the seance. And there would be like a curtained off cubicle called a cabinet, which would have a curtain pulled across it. And the medium, Helen Duncan, would actually sit in the cubicle and then the lights would be dimmed. Now, they wouldn't be switched off completely. There'd be like a 40-watt red bulb in one on one light. And that would be the only lighting in the room. Now, the skeptics will say this is so that she basically, the mediums could carry out magical tricks in the dark when no one could see them. You know, they can, they're props, they're fake trumpets and their little bits of string and their pieces of ribbon and stuff like that can be used in a way which the audience cannot spot. It's essentially a concealment exercise or concealment method. However, according to the psychical community, that's actually not what's happening. The reason the lights were switched off was in order to prevent damage to the ectoplasm and injury to the medium. Because bright lights could cause injury to a medium in trance who was exuding ectoplasm. Well, this actually did happen to Helen later on. In fact, she suffered a really bad injury in 1956, which led directly to her death, I believe.
And what injury was that and what were the circumstances?
In 1956, I mean, this after Helen came out of jail, she was very, very, she was bitter, she was angry, mostly because she wanted to perform in court, and she wasn't allowed to, and that really, really upset her, and she was very, very, she'd spent her 9 months in jail, and she got out, she never really got over the experience. She went back to practicing mediumship. The Witchcraft Act of 1735 was repealed, and in 1951 was replaced by the Fraudulent Mediums Act, which was a slight improvement. It was a bit fairer than the Witchcraft Act. That was only repealed in 2008. But the interesting thing about Helen was that she did have a couple of other brushes with the law. Now in 1956, she was performing at the West Bridgford Spurious Church in Nottingham. This is October 1956, and there was another police raid, just like at the Master Temple in 1944. And the police burst in and they switched the lights on. Helen suffered a second degree burn to her chest and her belly. And she was also put into deep shock. And the police wouldn't take her to hospital. It was really horrible. The police wouldn't take her to hospital. They detained her. And she was really, really sick. And they said, get her to hospital for goodness sake. They wouldn't do it. And Helen eventually went back home to Edinburgh to recover, but in December of that year she died. And her death certificate doesn't reveal it, but I think that the police raid actually led to her death. She was never a well woman. She was morbidly obese. She had diabetes and things like that. But I think the shock and the injury she sustained, the burn to her chest and belly, caused her death.
What do you think the burn actually was, Ben, like in psychic terms or physical terms?
According to the psychics, this does happen sometimes. If you disturb a medium in trance by switching on a light or causing any kind of commotion, sometimes the medium can suffer an injury like this. This is why doors are locked, lights are switched off, down, and the audience is told to keep very still, quiet.
I've actually met a medium who's done sort of physical mediumship, and she explained to me that the same sort of thing, that the light, physical light, is too much of a strong element to work with under physical seance conditions. And she said that there was a chap in her earlier days of doing this who was, again, a skeptical guy. And I don't know if he turned a torch on or put a light on or something, but basically she was exposed to normal daylight or room interior light, and she said that ectoplasm was coming out of her eye, I think she said, and it whipped back into her eye, but as it did so, it lashed against her face like a whip and caused like a burn across her face, apparently, she said. So
it can,
quite dangerous stuff in the wrong kind of conditions.
Yes, and this is this funny thing is, I actually went to this place. I managed to find out where this place in Nottingham was. It's not where today's Westbridge Spiritualist Church has its own premises, but it used to operate from a room in a house. And I managed to find out where this house was, and I went there I managed to film in the Master Temple because I made a couple of videos about this. But when I got to the house, the people there, they were still very cagey about it. They remembered it. There was an old lady there who remembered it, but she wouldn't speak to me, and she completely refused point blank to let me film in the house. And she even objected to me filming in the street outside. And I had to explain to her, you know, it's a public street, I could film here if I want. Oh, they're very, there's still a shadow cast over this, you know, in the spiritualist community in that area for what happened to Helen that day.
So obviously, once she came out of prison, and she was hounded by police still afterwards, you would have thought really that, do you think the authorities were trying to kind of keep on her toes and just sort of basically hound her to death, is one term, but hound her out of existence, because obviously she'd done her penance and stuff, and the war was then over. Why do you think they were still giving her grief?
Well, this is a good question. Why should the authorities care if some of us believe in spiritualism and want to practice spiritualism? And it's this maybe ties in more with the general skeptic thing. I mean, why? It's, you could ask questions. Why would they care if we believe in UFOs? Why do they make? Why do they ridicule the idea of UFOs, which I've talked about an awful lot as well? It's possibly to do with the way they want us to see the world. I think it's very important for them that we regard the universe in a particular way. The common people, so to speak, as they call us, looking down their nose at us, have a particular image of the universe and how it works. One of these is we're alone. We're a tiny little oasis of life in an infinite cosmic desert. So that brings in the UFO issue. It's one of the reasons why they regard UFOs. Also, I think they seem to want us to believe that basically there's no such thing as an afterlife unless you believe in one of the religious views of the afterlife. So you're allowed to be an atheist materialist like Richard Dawkins and say basically, when you die, that's it. You're gone forever. You just disappear. Or you could believe in God. God will judge you and send you to heaven or hell, etc., etc. You can have one of those two options, but there's no third position permitted. Spiritualism offers a third position, and I think this is obviously a third position that the government don't want us to have.
Now this very much leads into the whole kind of like Illuminati control structure in terms of keeping the masses dumbed down and stupid and watching, you know, soap operas and things and not focusing on what is the government really doing and what is life really all about.
Yeah.
Well, it's always an argument I've said is that if you can assassinate people, and governments do, you know, using other countries' henchmen to assassinate them, kind of keeps them separated from the nasty business they want to do undercover. But people like Helen Duncan and more modern mediums, physical mediums, can bring these people back. You know, for instance, imagine if you've got a physical medium who brought back Princess Diana. into a seance room, and she walked around and shook hands with people and claimed that she was murdered by XYZ people, that would be a very awkward position for whoever has authorized her death to be exposed to.
Very awkward.
you can see why the things like on TV, the announcements, you know, when you've got a demonstration of mediumship saying it's only for entertainment purposes only, etc., etc., and yet when you're watching a religious program, there's always a kind of never any announcement prior to that to say, you know, this Jesus stuff is just for entertainment purposes only. And yet, you know, spiritualism, it by law, is a legitimate religion. And so when you've got a person who's a medium, like your Tony Stockwell's or someone like that, demonstrating on a platform, on a TV show, they should be given a free rein to express it how they want to, rather than have this kind of disclaimer at the beginning or at the end of the program.
Yeah, it's some funny thing is, I mean, it's they don't do what they used to do. I mean, now I think I've never ever heard of police raiding a spiritualist church. How are they, like the gatekeepers, the Professor Brian Coxes, the Richard Dawkinses, the James Randys. They have the skeptics, who in a sense do that job for them. So you don't need to pass laws, you don't need to force people, when you can actually bring people who will, knowingly or not, confuse and distort and mislead.
With gatekeepers, obviously, like Brian Cox and people like that, misleading us, I think perhaps if we're in a time of a world war where things are a little bit more heated as such, and you've got your physical mediums bringing back people from sunken battleships or aircraft crashes or wherever it may be, that's potentially where you could see a repeat of a Helen Duncan type of trial. But I'd imagine it probably wouldn't be done as a trial if it was today's world. They might do a much more underhand thing and get rid of them in some way. What do you think to that, Ben?
Well, there's a part of me that's actually quite glad that Helen was imprisoned, because I think if the prosecution case had fallen apart, they may well have killed her. They may well have simply killed her. I mean, there's a situation where something similar happened in Alaska a few years ago. It was actually some gangsters who tried to kill a psychic medium because she was helping the police. Now, from their point of view, in a sense, I can sympathise in a sense. But then at the same time, I'd like to ask the government, why didn't they simply pay her off? I mean, Helen was a patriotic woman. She was behind the war effort, like most people were in those days. All they had to do was get her to sign the Official Secrets Act and just say, they didn't have to tell her why. They just said, look, we want you just to stop practicing for a few months, just for a few months, okay? We'll tell you when you can start again. Here's some money to compensate you for your loss of earnings, and just that's it.
Or even better than that, come and work for us.
Well, if she'd been in Germany at the time, she'd have been working for the SS, yeah. But I mean, honestly, that's all they had to do, and it could pay her more than what she was earning anyway, and it would have cost less than the trial. So I mean, it is obsolete tomfoolery, as Winston Churchill put it.
I think really at the end of the day, the government made fools of themselves, really, and exposed their own kind of misdemeanors as such. Anyway, we'd like to say thank you very much to Ben Emlyn-Jones for part one of this program, talking about medium Helen Duncan and the things that happened to her during World War II. And join us in a few moments after the break for part two, where we'll be discussing more interesting theories and skepticisms in the Paranormal Peep Show with myself and Andrew Chaplin.
See you in a bit, guys.
The work of medium Philip Kinsella.
The reading that I had by Philip this evening was spot on.
I feel it's important for those people who are waiting for their message from their loved ones to show how they passed over and what part they played in that person's life. The spirit will then probably talk about the person that they're coming through, about their life and about what they're worried about, what their concerns are. Normally a spirit will remember how they passed over, but sometimes it's not always the case. Sometimes a spirit will pass over very tragically, very violently, and they're left in confusion. So all I will get is a jumble of confused memories.
Was she spying on someone next door?
Always looking out the window.
Oh my goodness. I don't get the problem of spirits
sending in me into three people at one time. I may have what I call a cue jump that will come in, but I will notice that as I'm reading for a particular person in the audience, there's someone else knocking on the door basically wanting to come in. So once I finish my reading, I will then go to that person. Or, and sometimes it's difficult because when you get a cue jump or someone from the other side that seems to jump the cue, you've got to find your link with that person. Normally I go directly to an individual and read for them. Other times someone will come on and through to your consciousness and throw you slightly.
Yeah, okay. He was spot on with everything he said. There wasn't one thing he didn't say that wasn't true.
Okay. To find out more about the psychic work of Philip Kinsella, visit philip-kinsella.co.uk. That's philip-kinsella.co.uk.
Hello, welcome back to the Paranormal Peep Show with myself, Neil Geddes-Ward, and Andy Chaplin. And if you listen to the first part of the show, thanks, Andy. If you listen to the first part of the show, we were talking to our guest, Ben Emlyn-Jones, on the psychic medium, Helen Duncan, a wartime medium who was prosecuted under the Witchcraft Act. And Ben, before we leave the subject of Helen Duncan, if you could just give us the latest information that might be of interest to people who want to find out more about her, if there's a website, for instance, but also we understand there's some more of a kind of legal challenge to the case that was brought against her. Is that right?
That's right. I mean, there's an organisation which is a campaign to pardon Helen Duncan, which is run by Margaret Hahn, who is Helen's granddaughter, who has become a friend of mine. And you can find out details at www.helenduncan.org.uk. Now, this campaign has been going on for a long time. In one form or another, it really dates back to when she first came out of jail in 1944. But it's not had much luck recently. That they wanted to basically get her pardoned and get her conviction overturned and an apology from the government for what they did. Which is, the government has not been forthcoming. But there's been a new breakthrough, and it all comes round to a common law precedent which has been known as Turing's Law. Now, this is actually going through Parliament as a statute as well. But in 2013, the government pardoned Alan Turing. Now, Alan Turing is well known for being a very famous electronics wizard. He's a pioneer of artificial intelligence and computers. And he actually designed a computer called Enigma. A computer that could crack the famous Enigma encryption system that was used by Nazi Germany in World War II, the supposedly unbreakable code. This is a guy who should have been treated as one of Britain's greatest war heroes, but he was actually jailed for gross indecency under the Le Bruchery Amendment. Now, this basically means he was doing something which today is totally acceptable and even trendy. He was an out-of-the-closet homosexual. Now, he was treated very badly, actually. He was given medical procedures to turn him straight, which actually ruined his physical and mental health. And in 1954, he committed suicide. Now, in 13 years after that, in 1967, the Le Bruchery Amendment was repealed in the same way that in 1951, the 1735 Witchcraft Act was repealed, which meant basically that what was considered a crime at the time Turing was convicted was no longer an offence. Now, he's one of many, many people, actually. Well, some of them are still alive, others are campaigning for those who died. But there's a large number of people now campaigning for official pardons under the repeal of these archaic sodomy laws, as they were called. Now, the government has been very forthcoming. They apologized to Turing in 2008, and they officially pardoned him in 2013. But this means this sets a very, very important legal precedent, and this is going to be a statute, like I say, Turing's Law, is going to become real. But the passing of the Witchcraft Act by Parliament is considered to be one of these Enlightenment thinking processes, but of course it was an archaic law at the time that Helen was convicted, and not long after her conviction, it was repealed. So basically, what they're saying now is there's the Graham Hewitt, who's a man I've hoped to talk to pretty soon. He's a friend of Maggie's, and he says, the Turing Law has set a precedent for Helen's pardon to come, and it is one her family will welcome. The circumstances are almost identical. Like Alan Turing, Helen was convicted under legislation now long repealed. There is a precedent, and we are writing to the Scottish Government demanding that they do the same. So it's been a long time for justice for Helen Duncan, but it's coming soon. I think Helen Duncan is going to be pardoned. And apparently she's in the spirit world right now in regular contact with her family, so no doubt this will be welcome news to her.
That's quite an interesting scenario, actually. It's welcome news to me. Do you think when she's in the spirit world right now, she'd actually really worry about it because she's got a completely new kind of phase of life?
Apparently she's very supportive of this campaign.
Ah, I suppose from her point of view, wherever she may be in the spirit world or wherever you want to think of that place to be, maybe she sees it as a way of kind of actually helping other mediums in this present time and space that might come under some sort of prosecution issues and police issues.
Yeah, and this is the thing, and this would hopefully, it might, I mean, who knows where this could go? It could go to a reopening of the publicity surrounding Helen's case. And maybe an awareness of some of the things that I've been trying to talk about, like Maggie Hahn, her granddaughter, has been trying to talk about and trying to make publicly aware.
Now, was there a conference or something? I understand there was a planned conference or something. Was it last year? Or was it?
Well, there was a Helen Duncan convention in 2014, which I was a speaker at. There's been nothing since, but I did attend a conference a couple of months ago called the ASAPS, that's the Association for the Scientific Study of Anomalous Phenomena, the ASAP Seriously Suspicious Conference in London. It was at the Goldsmiths College, London. And I attended that, and I spoke about Helen Duncan there.
And how was that received?
Very well indeed. I mean, it was a challenging audience because they were kind of like half of them are sceptics, you know. But
Goldsmiths is where Chris French, of course, is, head of psychology.
Yes, he was one of the organisers of the event, and he's a very likeable chap, and we got on very well. And
that's very surprising to me, Ben, because I don't dislike Chris French. You know, I haven't got any bad feelings towards him, but he does come across as very hardcore, almost kind of Dawkins Cox hardcore, and I'm very surprised that your energies kind of like get on. Can you explain why that might be, Ben?
Probably because I've spent a lot of time with skeptics over the since I became a crazy nutcase, whatever they would. I've actually been looking. I've been looking at both sides of the story, and I do like to do this. I like to look at both sides of every issue, and so I've actually spent a lot of time with skeptics over the last few years. I'm a member of Oxford Skeptics in a Pub. I regularly attend their events. I sometimes travel to London and other places to attend other Skeptics in the Pub event. I attended the TAM London, a major Skeptic conference in 2010. I've known Professor French for a while. I get on well with him. I think we had more contact during this conference than before. And Skeptics, as I said, they are, some of them can be really quite unpleasant. And I've had some run-ins with some really nasty ones. So the ones that are actually civil towards me, I warm to. You know, I don't have a problem with them if they think differently to me. That's fine with me, as long as they're civil to me. Professor Chris French is actually quite a civil chap, and he is very hardcore. I mean, he used to edit Skeptic magazine. He's one of the world's principal skeptics, actually, and he's retired now, and he's sort of handed over the reins to his young apprentice, who's called Rob Brotherton, and I'm expected to hear more from him in the coming years. But he's a likable fella. He's a good guy.
And obviously, in your work with obviously you go to paranormal conferences. You've got your own paranormal radio show and things, and you talk to lots of different people. You do a really good presentation, which I was listening to recently. In fact, you had a chat with your friend Colin, who's your chief kind of skeptic on your Hipanwa radio discussion. Colin, forget his surname.
Colin Snuggs, He was on Hipanwa TV. I did a little video with him, yeah.
That's right, yeah. You had a kind of a skeptics debate with him, didn't you? And he's also commented on some of my videos, I think which you presented, actually, to do with UFOs and things like that. And, I mean, it's an interesting... They ask interesting questions, but you obviously have a way of trying to explain to it. Do they kind of just shut down and just don't want to listen to your explanation? Is there a psychology to the skeptic where they just don't want to hear the answers that might actually solve their problems?
It could be. I mean, to begin with, skeptics are... This is something I've been looking into. I've done an entire presentation on this, which you've watched as well, I know. Skeptics are a phenomena. The skeptic movement is a phenomenon. It's quite recent. I mean, you trace it back. There were a few individuals who you could call skeptics from the past years, but really it's a product of the 20th century. They are people who, well, describe themselves. I mean, this is how they describe themselves. A skeptic is one who rigorously and openly applies the methods of science and reason to all empirical claims. A skeptic provisionally proportions acceptance of any claims to valid logic and fair and thorough assessment of available evidence, and studies the pitfalls of human reason and the mechanisms of deception so as to avoid being deceived by others or themselves. Now, that is how a skeptic describes themselves. But is that a description or is it a slogan? I wonder if that's actually accurate.
Mm. So it sounds like they're failing to actually adhere to that kind of ruling because they kind of maybe don't know their own rules of the game, perhaps.
Well, we've already talked about that, about how, the skeptic will say things like, we need a rational explanation for that, and, well, is there a non-paranormal thing we can come up with first? Can we come up with a non-paranormal explanation for this? And so you say, well, let me think of one, and you just conjure up anything non-paranormal that's physically possible, and they can say, right, well, we really ought to consider this possibility before we consider any UFO-related possibilities, shouldn't we? Because this is non-paranormal. And that is
It's almost like they're kind of saying the default position is, well, of course it can't be paranormal, so there's got to be some other reason. It's almost like they cannot ever accept that there's a possibility that it could be paranormal.
Well, they consider, their vision of themselves, I think, is actually false.
Mm.
I think it's not like what it appears to be. It's not, but when I look at them and I've studied them from outside, not many people have done this from our side of the argument, very few. Mm. They've actually studied the skeptic movement from the position of being a tinfoil hat wearing, believing, loony, and whatever, you see, whatever they call us. And I think that they actually are self-deluded. They're a culture, they're a very inward-looking culture that has that is not seeing their own falsehoods. You see, they don't really have an awareness of their own falsehoods.
And in fact, I think they have a phrase actually that they use for us that actually applies to them. And that phrase is confirmation bias. They say of psychics, well, we go to a ghost hunt and we tune into spirit, and that knock on the window, that tap on the door, you know, you're confirming your own bias that there are spirits out there. I would knock that ball straight back in their court and say, well, they're going on ghost hunts as skeptics and parapsychologists trying to debunk it, and they're trying to confirm to themselves that there's a rational explanation and it's just a load of old rubbish. They're looking specifically for rational explanations, which, okay, I can understand, but it seems to be that a lot of skeptics I've come across, because I have kind of brushes with them myself as well, because I don't know if you know it or not, Ben, but I kind of do clairvoyant events and ghost hunts and demos and stuff myself, so I've sort of like brushed shoulders with them, and I've come across some cynical ones and nasty ones, but I've also come across ones that are civil. And the ones that are civil, I actually find quite interesting. I find it quite interesting to kind of get their point of view on things. And it's almost like they're going out with a view to confirm to themselves that it's all rubbish, and to confirm to themselves that it's, of course, it's plumbing, it's dodgy plumbing, it's dodgy electrics, it's just wind blowing the door, and almost kind of like throwing the baby out with the bathwater, in my opinion.
And they have a reasoning system in which they can almost, it's almost like whatever evidence is presented before them, they have an internal reasoning system that allows them to dismiss it. They don't realize this. They'll say, we're only looking for the evidence. All we want is the evidence. The evidence is not there. But you say, well, there's several different methods they use, that they use in many cases, honestly. I think they do it in sincerity. It's almost essentially, it's basically bad logic. I was going to say, I believe that at a higher level, a skeptic movement is actually controlled by what you might want to call psychological warfare organizations. I mean, they've got, there's distinct evidence for this. However, carry on.
I was just going to say, like, what you're saying there, it's almost like they've got fallback positions. So let's say something kind of very abnormal and kind of like paranormally, supernaturally happens in front of them. They will always have a fallback position. Oh, well, it can't be that, so it's got to be this. And then you might be able to disprove them on that. And then they'll have another position. Well, okay, but we've got to look at this as well, and that as well, and that as well. And they'll keep going back and back and back and back. And there's always kind of like a twist and a corner that they can turn to come back with something. Well, it can't be paranormal, it has to be something else, but that something else can be a multiple array of things.
Yeah, I mean, a perfect example is the Rendlesham Forest incident, which we've already discussed. They're coming up with the most outrageous explanations for it now. I mean, there's the lighthouse theory, and there's also someone said, oh, there was a truckload of burning manure in the vicinity that these highly trained Air Force security specialists mistook for an alien spacecraft. what a pile of manure that is.
Well, it's been put down to satellites, and supposedly someone's got evidence to suggest the satellite did re-enter the Earth's atmosphere on that night, or one of the nights concerned of the Rendlesham case. But
Or a helicopter. One of my favourites is the joyriding ice cream van.
apparently,
yes. Apparently, some local thugs broke into some guy's house, and he's a local ice cream vendor. In the winter, of course, he wasn't working, but he worked in the summer selling ice cream in Woodbridge. And they stole his ice cream van and went on a joyride with it, and they drove it around Capel Green with the lights and the music playing and the jingles and things like that. And that's what these guys saw. These are very highly intelligent and highly trained Air Force officers.
Now, you get your ice creams left at East Gate.
Yeah. Stop me and buy one at East Gate. It's crazy, isn't it? It's absurd. But, I mean, this is a perfect example of what I'm talking about because, of course, if imagine Rendlesham Forest had been very, very different. In other words, some guy's walking his dog in the woods, comes across the alien spacecraft. Right, what would the skeptics say? They would say, well, how come no one at the base saw it? Why didn't they send the guards out with the security police out to check it out? How come they didn't, walk around the woods taking audio recordings and radiation readings and things like that? If they'd done that, I would believe you. But until then, there's just not enough evidence. And what have I just described? I've just described a situation in which they raised the bar. Because all those things that I've just described did happen at Rendlesham Forest, yet still the skeptics demand more.
Yeah, yeah.
Their thirst for evidence is unquenchable when it comes to things like this. Alternatively, I mean, they will accept a non-paranormal explanation with almost no scrutiny at all. And I'll give you a good example of that. Skeptics call themselves they regard themselves as the ultimate purveyors of reason and logic. But have you heard of psychic Sally Morgan?
Yes. Yeah, I've seen her. Seen her live in Weymouth. She gave me a reading.
Oh, good. Yeah, she's great. She appeared in Dublin at a theatre doing one of her live shows, as she does. And somebody reported to the local media that they heard a voice backstage that was given details that they heard a voice saying these details and Sally was repeating them. Okay. Now, this for the skeptics, this harkened back to one of the biggest skeptic coups of all time, which, to be fair, was a good call. James Randi exposed the evangelical preacher Peter Popoff, and he discovered that Peter Popoff was using a radio earpiece, and he was getting basically hot reading. He was getting secret information from his wife, who was reading out basically information about the people he was getting information on, which he said came from angels and from God, and transmitting it to this earpiece in his ear. Now, in this case, James Randi sent someone in with a scanner and picked up the actual the transmission and recorded it. Okay. So the skeptics, as soon as the skeptics heard what Sally was doing, they said, well, it's obvious she's doing the same thing. She's got a radio earpiece in her ear, and someone backstage is sending her information. That's how she knows all this stuff, which she says she gets psychically. She doesn't. She gets it from somebody just talking into a microphone, and she's getting it from her radio earpiece. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
Now, the problem is, as soon as this got out into the media, this hearsay was magically transformed into solid fact in the minds of the skeptics. They didn't do what James Randi did. They didn't send in anyone with any scanning equipment. Someone called Paul Zenon, who's a well-known skeptic, he wrote in the column in the Daily Mail that this is what Psychic Sally was doing. She was basically pulling a pop-off. And the skeptic, of course, being the ultimate purveyors of evidence, knew this immediately, even though they hadn't gathered. And Sally was, well, Sally actually received a lot of death threats and things like that from various people. She had the most obscene, threatened with the most obscene violence. She was called every name under the sun. She sued the Daily Mail and got £185,000 in damages plus costs. Very richly deserved. And the skeptics didn't even respond to this. They didn't even realise what a massive blunder they'd made. They sort of flailed around. It was hardly mentioned. There was a couple of made excuses on the skeptic forum, but basically they just went quiet about the whole thing. But this was a monumental cock up on the part of the skeptics, because they had accused someone without any evidence at all of doing something, because they just thought. And I actually got into a discussion with a skeptic about this, and I said, "Well," he said, "Well, which is more likely? Is she getting information from the spirit world, or is someone transmitting it through an earpiece?" And I said, "Well, are you going to take that to court?" So the skeptics actually have no idea what real evidence is. They have no idea how to apply it. They fool themselves into thinking they do. And they get so overconfident because of this internal delusion that they have, that they carry out these ridiculous, utter flamingos, like they did with Sally Morgan.
With Sally Morgan, having the fact that I've seen her, I can perhaps offer some kind of interesting observations of her show. I saw her in Weymouth, and I've also seen Derek Acora in Weymouth at the Weymouth Pavilion, maybe about a year prior. And I have to say, the difference between the two was quite astounding. And I'm not saying that Sally Morgan was the best medium I've ever seen. She wasn't. She was good, but she certainly wasn't the best I've seen. But Derek Acora, I'd have to say, and I'm quite happy to say this in public, in my opinion, he was the worst medium I've ever seen. So if he was a total fake in the sense of using the same technique, you would have thought he would have got it a lot better. You know, you thought his radio transmitter and receiver system would have been working hands down, and he would have been given brilliant readings. But in fact, it was embarrassing to watch, I'd have to say. You know, he wasted half the show moving his little table around on the stage and wiping his brow of all the sweat, probably because he was not sure how the show was going to go. I don't know. But he was coming out with names and no one could take the names. And he actually physically walked down the steps of the stage into the audience to see if anyone was going to take the name. And you could almost see desperation in the sweat of his brow, because no one could accept the names. And that he fell back, unfortunately, on what mediums always do when they're not getting a very good reception, and it's maybe it's a technique. I mean, I guess me and Andy have seen it maybe quite a lot in our own kind of study of this thing, because we've kind of trained in this area a little bit as well. Is that he would always say, "Well, I've got your grandmother here, love, and she offers you love, and she's offering you flowers." And the other technique that he was doing was saying that "I've got your grandmother here, love, and she says that when you leave tonight in the car, listen out for a noise on your dashboard of the car, because she's going to make a knocking sound." And of course, there's no way of knowing whether this girl, when she drives home that evening, will hear a knocking sound from her grandmother. And the trouble is, even if there is a knocking sound on her dashboard, you can't, as skeptics would quite rightly say, you can't rule it out to be a noise in the car anyway.
Yeah.
So it's not the best place for grandmother to make contact, is the noise of a rattling car, really.
Yeah.
A quiet bedroom would be a much more serene place to do it, I'd imagine, a much more objective place to do it. But Derek Acora was the worst. But if they're all using a cold body language reading, then Derek Acora was failing miserably at it. I just think he may have some limited psychic ability, but he certainly was not Britain's best medium, as he claims to be.
I have to say, when he first started out, I quite liked him, and I think there was something like genuine with him, because he was on Predictions with Sky TV probably about circa 1999, before he did Most Haunted and all that kind of thing. I went to see him twice, one in Hemel Hempstead and one in Apollo. I think it was Apollo. The London one, he was actually quite good. The Hemel one, he wasn't quite so good. But I will say, from my personal experience of doing demos myself as well, you will always get good nights and bad nights, and I've experienced that myself. I mean, my worst was in Boxford, and I'd arrived there late. Should have seen that one coming. Arrived there late because of huge traffic on the M11. and I was all flustered. Somebody else had to cover for me. I kind of got there halfway, and because I was so stressed, I just literally got nothing right at all. However, other occasions I've done demos where the accuracy has even astounded me, where I like it when even I am kind of like are taken aback with some of the stuff that comes through, which I don't credit myself for. I credit like Spirit for doing that, but I've had that as well. So I would say, kind of in Derek's defense, although I think he's kind of gone down the theatrical route in the recent kind of Most Haunted episodes, I think to begin with, he was hit and miss, but then I think a lot of mediums are hit and miss. What do you think, Neil?
Yeah, and as you say, and Ben's obviously got some experiences of going to spiritualist shows, haven't you, Ben? You've obviously seen good performances by mediums and bad performances, and sometimes you go and see what you hope to be a really good demonstration by your favourite medium, and they're just not as good as they were, like, you know, last summer or something. But, you know, having said that, I've seen some mediums that are average, and I've seen some mediums that are really, really good. And the trouble is that, I mean, we went to the spiritualist church here in Weymouth on Sunday evening just gone, and you kind of wish, why did I bother? Because it was really boring and just pretty averagely boring, in fact. And that's the problem with spiritualist churches. They're putting people out on platform that are just not ready for it or even trained properly for it. What do you think?
Yeah. Well, sometimes the skeptics do get it right sometimes. I mean, I mentioned Peter Popoff. That was definitely a legitimate coup on the part of the skeptics. It was a legitimate bust on a man who was fake, totally fake. They do, and Jericho Corridge, he's been caught out a few times by the skeptics. I mean, if you Google Creed Kafer, Kafer, just Google that, and you'll see they basically fed him a yarn secretly to see if he'd take the bait, and he did. Creed Kafer, supposedly a South African prison warder, who died. He went to South Africa and he was supposedly channeling this dead South African prison warder. Turns out it was a fake story that they planted to see if he'd go for it, and he did.
And I believe it was Kieran O'Keefe who set him up. And Creed Kafer is actually
an anagram
of Derek Faker. And what they did is they wrote it on a piece of paper, put it on the floor, see if he would pick up on it, and also told some of the production staff to kind of whisper it slightly out of earshot, but just so he can just pick up on it. And sure enough, we got Creed Kafer. Creed Kafer. Thank you, Sam. What's that again? Creed Kafer.
The guy, I mean, whether he's real or not, I mean, he may have some real talent, but he's the problem is even real performers will sometimes be tempted to fake just to keep up their performance. I mean, this happens on Paranormal.
I think that's exactly right, Ben. Yeah, I think that
Paranormal shows.
This
counts for Paranormal TV. I mean, I know a guy. He's a producer. He's produced several TV shows. He starred in a couple of TV shows, and he was offered the chance to do another program for one of the big networks. He was offered a team of staff. He was offered a big budget, and they said, "We want you to do a ghost investigation series. You know, visit haunted houses, stuff like this. It'll be one of the top shows around." And he said, "Cool, that's great. Just one thing though, we're going to have to fake a couple of things if you don't get the results you need. We do need to be able to have at least in every episode at least one paranormal thing. So if you can't find anything real, we will have to fake some stuff." And this guy, to his credit, his name's Ross Hemsworth. He's a good friend of mine. To his credit, he got up and he walked out. And he refused to have anything to do with it. But some of them won't. You see, some of them will they will do that deal with the devil, and they will take that, they will go for it, you know.
As I say, if you watched, probably won't be able to see them, but Predictions in the 1990s, 1999, very, very early for Derek's career, I think, he was actually all right. He didn't have kind of like the theatrics. I think Most Haunted went on and on and on. And I think, you know how it is with the shows, the next series has got to be bigger. It's got to be better. You know, that kind of American thing of making big and bold and, you know, better than everything else. And like, I think Derek got caught up in the theatrics. It started off with just a ghost investigation, and it turned into pantomime at the end of it, in my opinion.
I think again, going back to the one I saw at Weymouth of Derek Acora, you know, he makes a statement on his website that he's Britain's best medium, always continually filling out theatres. Well, when I got to this theatre, I mean, I did question why I was there, but the ticket was bought for me, so I thought, well, I'll go along, try and give him the benefit of the doubt, because obviously I'd heard about these various accusations and controversies to do with the programs he's been involved with and being caught out. But I thought, okay, my brother thought he had got a pretty good reading off him once in the theater, I'll give it a go. As the ticket's been bought for me, I'll go. But there wasn't even half an audience there, which was quite embarrassing. And then during the first half, it was really, really bad. And then during the break, we all went out, and there was like a silence in the audience as we all shuffled out, thinking, is that it? And then at the very end of the show, we all shuffled out again, and everyone was in silence. There was no excitement, no talking about it like you would if you'd just be really impressed by someone. It was just like thinking, what have we just paid for, kind of feeling.
Now, Neil, when you went to see Sally Morgan, am I right in thinking she came to you and gave you a reading?
Yeah, what happens, she's on stage. It was the same theatre, and this time it was pretty, I wouldn't say maximum to the brim, but it was pretty much fuller than Derek Acora was. And they have a guy on stage with a video camera, and there's a big screen behind her, so that basically when she's given a reading for someone, so that people can see who she's given a reading to, the guy on stage with the video camera will zoom in, and someone hands you a microphone so you can be heard over the PA system, and you can see yourself on the big screen, which is just fantastic. And it's basically you start to obviously say yes or no according to what she's given you, yeah.
And was she accurate? What did she nail things on the head for you?
I'm trying to remember how she came to me. She started to talk about someone called Brian and a Mary. And she says, can anyone take Mary connected with a Brian? Now, I personally don't have that in my family, but my daughter's boyfriend, his mother was called Mary, and she died about 2 years ago, and her husband's called Brian. And that kind of rang a bell with me. So basically, I said, yeah, I think I can possibly take that. So I had to stand up, given a microphone. There I was on the big screen. And they spoke about something, and I can't remember exactly what information was about socks on a radiator or something like that, that he doesn't wash. He takes his socks off. Instead of putting them in the wash, he just sticks them on the radiator, and they're all sweaty to dry. And it caused a bit of a laugh with the audience. Now, I couldn't vouch whether that was true or false. That piece of information, I just said I'll have to check on that. But I can't really remember the rest of the reading. So it was a little bit hit and miss, I have to say. You know, it might have been valid for me. I did pass the information back to my daughter's boyfriend, who is a skeptic. So he was a bit umming and ahhing about the whole thing. So it was not conclusive, I have to say. But go on.
No, carry on.
But I have therefore seen other mediums, and there's a guy, I'll mention his name, quite happy to mention names, Ross Bartlett. He's a young medium from the Southampton area. I would say he's about 23 now, roughly. Apologies if I got that wrong. As of January 2017, roughly he's about that age. And I'd heard whispers around the town, as it were, you must go and see this guy. And my girlfriend had seen him first of all. And then we managed to catch up with him when he came and did a demonstration in Ruislip. And a guy who I was in a development circle with, Gary White, you may know Gary, possibly. I kept telling Gary, you got to get this guy up in your area because he really is good. And eventually came to the Ruislip area, which is in Middlesex. And my girlfriend and I, we managed to sort of get tickets, although the tickets were got for me by Gary. And the idea was that I was going to pay Gary there on the night, and I was just going to pick up the tickets at the door. This is where it gets kind of freaky, because I'd really love a skeptic to explain this. Okay, and I'll just relate that story as quick as I can for everybody. Basically, we arrived there a little bit late because we had trouble trying to find the right building, because there were three or four buildings. They all looked the same. We had to go to every single building to find out which one it was. And we finally got the right one. We went in, the door was open, there was a guy in a white shirt at the table, and he said, just go and sit over there in the corner. So we went in, and everyone's already there, it's already started, so you think, oh God, we're late. So we shuffled down quietly as we could, and we happened to sit sort of like sideways to where the medium was doing his demonstration. And anyway, I had my digital recorder there with me. So, you know, if anyone wants to listen to this recording or you want me to play it at some point, I can't obviously do it in tonight's show because it's not prepared, but I can play that on a later show if necessary. And basically, after about the first reading, he suddenly looked at me and he said, I want to come to the gentleman on my left. And he looked across at me. So I said, oh, hello there. So I started recording my digital recorder. And he said, I've got the name of Evie or Evis or something like that. And I said, sorry, I don't know that name. So I was thinking, I hang on, I think you've got the wrong person. And he said, Evie, who's connected, your brother knows about her. Because he's researched into her grave, your brother Phil. And as soon as he said the word Phil, I thought, I do have a brother called Phil, and my brother does go around photographing family gravestones. So I thought, well, this is now making a sort of sense, but I couldn't take the relative. But he said, she's your auntie who's married to Edward. And I thought, I'm sorry, I haven't got an auntie called Evis who's married to Edward. So it didn't make any sense, but as I say, the brother Phil bit did. So I thought, there's something going on here, let's just carry on, sort of thing. But then he said, she's talking about Morgan. I said, yes, that's my daughter. So I thought, that's a second hit there, that's quite good. This is getting very good, in fact. And she said, you know, she calls in on Morgan because she likes to see how she's doing. Now, he paused for a minute and he was in doubt about himself. You could see the doubt that he was having about what he was getting through, thinking, should he say this or not? And he was kind of nodding to someone you couldn't see, like a spirit or whatever. And he said, okay, I'll go for it. He said, now, do you see the gentleman over there in the corner? And he pointed to the guy with a white shirt who waved us through the door, the guy on the table. And I said, yeah. And he said, well, that guy over there is called Mr. Chris Hayes. And as soon as he said that, I thought, oh, my God, I know what's coming. He said, Evie is saying that Chris Hayes, the name Chris Hayes, is also connected with Morgan that you know. And I said, absolutely bang on right. I said, my daughter Morgan, who was 21 at the time, is going out with a gentleman also by the name of Chris Hayes.
That's a bit weird.
That was incredibly weird. Strange coincidences, if you want to call them that, but just too freaky for words, because not only has he got the full name right, he's also got the fact that there's two Chris Hayeses, and he's connected this one with my Chris Hayes. You know, and people say, oh, but he knew where you was going to sit, but we arrived late and the tickets weren't in our name, things like that, you know. So I'd like the skeptics to explain that. And also the other thing, the fact that I couldn't get the name of the relative right, well, I went back to my mum maybe a day or two later to say, who is Evie? And she goes, I don't know. So she started to ask him my family about it. She ended up speaking to my dad's sister over the telephone. And she goes, oh, I know who she is. She is Auntie Doris. But she never used her first name because she didn't like it. So she always used her middle name, which was Doris. So in fact, Evie was her first name by default, but she always used the name Doris, and she happened to be married to what we knew as Uncle Ted, i.e. Edward, which was the Edward mentioned at the very beginning of the reading that I couldn't understand, you see. So all the dots connected perfectly from my position. So there we go. That's what I consider a very, very good reading.
And that also knocks out of the water cold reading, because people say, oh, well, they, you know, obviously kind of like they're reading it off the person in the audience. They're, you know, body language or whatever, or I don't know how they do the cold reading thing, but that's what they're doing, because you didn't know that information at the time, and you, that was not even in your mind, so it couldn't have been plucked out of your mind if it's not in your mind.
That's right. And then there's also the claim that people get it off Facebook or they get it off Google and things like that, and
you can't with that. You can't.
Well, yeah, my auntie died well before the internet was ever on the scene, and so did her husband Ted. And as I say, it was my belief that she was always called Doris, never Evie, never even heard of the name Evie. So it just didn't make any sense to me, you see. So and then for them to get the information to connect my daughter's boyfriend with the fact that the guy in the corner was happened to have the same name and they used him. So they must have like planted the image of this guy in Ross Bartlett's mind to say, use this guy as a name. And in fact, that happens with me, and it probably happens with you, is that when you're having to give a name out to the audience, you're sometimes often shown a name of someone you know.
That's it,
because that's the same name as the person in the audience knows. For instance, when my daughter started going out with her boyfriend, I was telling her about how I'm getting on in my psychic developing circle, and I said, I'm starting to get names. And she said, well, can you guess the name of my boyfriend's mum? And she goes, I'll give you a clue. It starts with M. And I said, oh, I wish you hadn't said that. And I just said, Mary. And she goes, well, how did you know that? I said, oh, all right, it's because you said M. And she said, okay, well, give me the name of Chris's, her boyfriend's dad. And then as soon as she said that, I saw an image of my own father, who is called Brian. So I just said to my daughter, Brian. And she goes, oh, my God, that's exactly his name, Brian. You see? So that's how they work. They give you names of people you know, you see?
Yeah, yeah. Now, going back to the Sally Morgan thing, there is a video of her coming off stage, taking out an earpiece. And I think this is kind of something that, again, Paul Zenon very much focuses on. And I think Paul has got a valid point. But there's actually arguments and counter arguments with this. Because first of all, yes, she was coming off stage and she was pulling an earpiece out of her ear. But the counter argument would be, if she was pulling out the wire from her ear because she's being fed information, wouldn't she want to keep that secret, and wouldn't she want to cover up her ear and not pull it out in front of the camera? Because it was very obvious that the camera was right in her face, and she was pulling it out in front of the camera with no shame or no kind of scruples about it. It's kind of like
no attempt to conceal.
No attempt to conceal. So surely if it was for nefarious reasons, she would either cover it up, or she would kind of put a shawl over her head, wait till she's in the dressing room, and then take it out. Why would she take it out in front of a camera? But then another argument would be, if you're a genuine medium, why the hell have you got a wire in your ear on stage at all? If it was me, I don't care what the reason is, what the stage manager says, or what the production team says, I'm not having a wire in my ear, because that opens up the floodgates for skeptics. If it's time to wrap up and they need a break or something, flash the lights or something, or have somebody down below, flashing a torch or something. I don't want anything in my ear. So I think she was maybe naive and maybe foolish to have the wire in her ear. But it was actually my friend Voodoo Mick, actually, who pointed out, why would she take it out with the camera right in her face if there was an attempt to conceal, because obviously she wasn't concealing it.
And also, I mean, if I was a skeptic, I mean, I could put myself in their shoes. In fact, Martin Robbins is the only skeptic who's actually been honest enough to say this. Why didn't they, as soon as they suspected that Sally Morgan was doing something like this, based on this hearsay evidence they heard, hearsay anecdote that had been broadcast on, which Irish TV covered, the thing to do is just her next show. Anyone got a radio scanner? Let's go to her next show. Let's actually do what James Radley did with Peter Popoff and actually get the evidence first before accusing her.
Or actually, if you're in the audience, kick up a fuss. Stand up and say, I'm sorry, but I'm hearing this being said outside and it's repeating. Because then you could then have a few people, and there probably would be some people who would do this in the audience, who would immediately rush out the fire exits, rush out the doors, and see if there's somebody out there with a radio. And if there is somebody out with a radio, then you've got them bang to rights. End of story.
Yeah. Because honestly, if she was actually caught red-handed the way Popoff was, I would say kick her out, drum her out of the entire business forever. She's guilty. Kick her out. I would actually be 100% behind the skeptics on that. But the very fact that they didn't even understand the necessity to actually gather real evidence before making accusations is just an illustration of their own self-delusion.
Yeah. I've got a funny story about radio scanners, actually.
Yeah, go for it. Go for it.
It's quite a funny one, actually. There's a medium called Susan DeVere in Harlow, and she was doing the Harlow Playhouse, and some bugger had got hold of a radio scanner, which also kind of like... it's a two-way radio, basically, so they could also broadcast, and they did. So she was doing her clairvoyant thing with an audience in Harlow Playhouse, and some bugger with a scanner was going, ooh, and even Susan herself was kind of wondering what's going on, are the spirits around? But apparently, no, it was just some jackass with a radio.
Oh dear! Did that interfere with their demonstration?
Yes, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. It kind of like it picked up on the speakers. It picked up on the theatre speakers somehow. They'd managed to kind of like, because she was using a wireless microphone. They'd kind of like somebody with tech kind of skills managed to scan into the frequency of the playhouse, and then over the theatre speakers just do a woo type noise.
I have to say,
They couldn't get rid of it.
I've never seen any other medium use earpieces or anything. I mean, going back to pre-internet days, back in the late 80s, I remember seeing a guy called Gordon Higginson, who was the head of the Spiritualist National Union. Have you heard of him, Ben?
Yeah, yes, I have. I've heard that name. I mean, I don't know much about it.
Yeah. One of the, well, probably the top guy of the 20th century as far as doing physical medium. Well, he also was a physical medium, I understand. There's very little YouTube footage of him, unfortunately. There is a little bit, but not a lot, because it's all VHS tapes and things in those days. But I remember going to see a demonstration of him at Uxbridge Civic Centre in the late 80s, and I went with a friend. And it's the amount of information that he pulled out, you know, and again, you'd have to either say either everyone in the audience was plants or something like that, or he was getting it from some other way, you know, supernatural, something like that. But, you know, he said to this guy that was there sitting in the audience, and he said, you, sir, you were, before you came out tonight, you were not wearing the coat that you've presently got on. In fact, you came out of your house, you got in your car, and you decided that this coat wasn't comfortable, so you went back into your house, you took off your coat, you threw it on the bed and your car keys, you went to your wardrobe, you got out another coat, you then put it on, then you grabbed your car keys and came out in your car. And the bloke said, yeah, that's absolutely right. And he says, and your car is now parked below us in the car park below the building. And he says, and my helpers, meaning his spirit guides, are just going down to the multi-story car park below the building now, and they're just identifying your car for me, and they've come back, and it's a red blah, blah, blah type of car with a registration number PYE71. And he actually couldn't get the whole registration plate. he said something, then he said the last letter, because he wasn't quite clear on the last two digits or something like that of the registration plate. But he got it pretty 99.5% accurate, and everyone was totally gobsmacked. And this guy also used to give out people's door numbers, used to give out phone numbers and everything, you know. He was that good. And I remember talking to a guy I worked with the next day and saying how bowled over by I was by this medium. And he goes, oh, he's a fake. And I said, well, listen, if he's a fake, how does he do it? And he goes, I don't know. So, you know, that's the first thing. Before you declare it a fake, please tell me how they do it, you know. And okay, he might have said, if he came out with the first argument, oh, he's using an earpiece and the information fed back. Well, at least it opens up a dialogue. Okay, let's look into this further then. But the fact is, he goes, I don't know, but it's definitely a fake. It's just, well, you're destroying yourself, aren't you, in that kind of sceptic kind of approach.
But the problem is, what the sceptic will say is, what the answer you'll often get when you say, well, you can't explain it, I'll say, it's the burden of proof is on you to explain how he does it, not how to me to explain how he's a fake. So in other words, the fake is the default position. So basically, your this particular medium is actually guilty until proven innocent because of this burden of proof argument, which again is very arbitrary from a kind of a moral point of view. Why should the burden of proof only be one way? And then if that doesn't work, they'll fall back on the coincidence line. I could tell you a bit about that. They'll say, well, he's not cold reading. They know he's not cold. Well, then it's just a coincidence, isn't it? He just happened to say something which coincidentally resembled what was really true. And that again, is the ultimate cop-out for the skeptics. And it's another area of their fallacy, because to say anything that is physically possible in this universe can happen. It doesn't matter how unlikely it is. If it's physically possible, however unlikely it is, you can never, ever say that can never happen. I mean, there's a great book called Beyond Coincidence, which really, really opened my eyes. And it made me realize that some skeptics will call coincidence on things, but then they will not actually define a statistical ceiling above which they will not use that explanation. So, for example, I had got into a debate with a guy called Dr. Paul Rogers about this at one of the ASAP conferences. And I said, he was like pulling out the coincidence joker out of his sleeve over something. And I said, right, well, supposing you know a guy who won the national lottery. You think that's a coincidence? And he says, of course, yes, it's people win it by chance. What if the same man won it the following week? And the following week after that? What if the same man won the national lottery 5 weeks in a row? Would you call that a coincidence? And you say, no, of course not. That's far too unlikely to happen by chance. I say, right, where's the cutoff point? Mm. Where is the statistical ceiling above which you will check? And he says, well, it's kind of... And he could not give me an actual figure on it. He couldn't actually state exactly where the cutoff point was, which means, in a sense, he could pull a coincidence line any time for any reason, for anything, no matter how unlikely. And until he actually states, I think until there's an agreed level, you could put it in p-values or percentages or use Bayesian analysis, whatever you like. Until there's an actual level where everyone has agreed, below that level, that could be a coincidence, and above it, it can't. To use the coincidence line is essentially it's an unfalsifiable hypothesis. And that's another of the many sceptical fallacies.
I've got a small story, actually, about one of Neil's workshops that I did. I don't think Neil was there on this particular one. So this was back in, I think, about June or July time at the High Wycombe Paranormal. And I was doing a kind of ESP kind of tele... what's the word?
Telekinesis?
Not telekinesis, that's moving objects. Telepathic.
Telepathic, as I call it. Yeah,
telepathic and ESP type workshop. And Ben, you're well aware of psi cards, aren't you? Kind of like these cards like created in the 1920s.
Zener cards.
Yeah, the kind of different names, Zener cards, psi cards. And they've got like squares and triangle and kind of curly things, wavy lines. And they're in the 1920s. And the idea is that one person holds them up where the other person can't see it. And they're try and transmit it, and that the other person's got to kind of write down or draw the shape of what they think they're getting. Now, these particular psi cards, as I call them, the original pack in the 1920s was kind of five, so you'd have a 1 in 5 chance, but I like to kind of like up it a little bit and make it a bit harder. I actually created 10 different symbols myself, so they were my kind of designs, and I kind of printed them out onto cardboard. Now, a friend of mine called Indigo was doing this amongst the group, and she scored 100%. I've never, ever, ever come across somebody who scored 100%. It's good to get maybe 2, 3, 4. She got 1 in 10 correct 10 times in a row. We actually worked that out to be 10 to the power of 10, 1 in a trillion chance of that happening.
Well, what a coincidence. That's an amazing coincidence, isn't it?
Well done.
The person that she was working with was called Steve, and he does kind of like ghost boxes and scientific. He's a very rational guy, very kind of scientifically driven guy. He was making darn sure that she couldn't see the cards, and I was watching what was going on, and she was even shutting her eyes as she was getting this, so she wasn't even looking at the cards, and they weren't in collusion, because Steve is not like that, and Neil knows Steve, and Neil knows that Steve is not like that. And I just couldn't believe it. I was asking people, okay, how many people have got one right? And, you know, most people put hands up. How many people two right? A few hands went up. How many people got three right? A few hands went up. 4, 5, 6. I was almost about to give up on like 7, 8, 9. And I'd noticed Indigo still hadn't put her hand up. And she looked at me and she said, I got 100%.
I got fantastic. All 10 right.
I've never, ever... come across that. How, you know, I wish somebody like Chris French or, you know, James Randi or Brian Cox was there, because I'd love to hear their explanation as to what was going on.
I know exactly what they would say. They would dismiss it. They would say either it's a coincidence or it's sensory leakage. It doesn't matter. Your friend Steve may have been very, very scientifically minded. He has done everything he could to prevent sensory leakage. He could have said, well, she shut her eyes and stuff like this. He'd still say, well, even so, we're still going to say it's sensory leakage, even if there's no evidence of it, because that's the onus. They always use that word onus. I never heard the word onus until I started talking to skeptics. The onus, the burden of proof, is on you to prove that there was no sensory leakage. It's not the burden of proof of me to prove that there was. And then it will be the coincidence card. The coincidence line will come up, and they say this every time. I mean. Oh, well, James Randi has his $1 million challenge, you see. But the thing about it is, I mean, what not many people are aware of, he's actually been sued over that $1 million challenge.
He'll just keep raising the bar. That's what he'll do.
Yeah. The thing about it is that $1 million challenge is worth nothing unless there is a this experiment is designed so that that he could fail. Mm. And as we've seen from skeptics, they have all kinds of little tricks up their sleeve. Sometimes they're doing it deliberately, and sometimes they do it unknowingly. But as I said, we don't have time to talk about this now. But there's a reason why there is evidence to suggest that the intelligence services and the psychological warfare organisations are behind the skeptic movement. Behind much of it.
Well, before we close, I'll just say this quick coincidence I had, and then we'll have to close the show because we're nearly running out of time. Bizarre coincidence, whether it was or not, I don't know, but I remember doing some work not that long ago, about 2 years ago, and I was coming out of work late at night, and I happened to pop to McDonald's, which I don't normally do, just to grab a coffee because I had a long drive ahead of me, and I was going to head down to my girlfriend's on the south coast, and I was actually heading out of Hemel Hempstead. And so I grabbed a McDonald's coffee, and when I was in there, I discovered that McDonald's had changed over the years, because as I say, I never go there, and they've got all these kind of computer terminals at the desks and tables. And I thought, crikey, this is just like Back to the Future. How things have changed here. And then when I got in the car, I started to think about the Back to the Future films and thought, what a great load of films they were. I really enjoyed them. And then I started to think about how things have changed, you know, since, now we're actually at that time in the future where we've got computers and phones and Skype and stuff like that. And anyway, as I got onto the slip road and onto the M1 motorway, I was heading sort of southwards. I could see a vehicle ahead of me. And this is only sort of 5 minutes after I got the coffee. And it's a pickup vehicle. And would you believe, on the back of the pickup vehicle was the DeLorean car time machine. And I was absolutely totally gobsmacked by the whole thing. I just couldn't believe it. Here I was thinking about Back to the Future. And then 3 or 4 minutes later, I'm actually seeing the Back to the Future car on a pickup truck.
It's a conspiracy, Marty.
That's right. Yeah.
Great Scott. Because what Carl Jung would have been really interested in that, because he talked about these kinds of synchronicities, about things that he believed. You see, he wasn't scared to say that's too unlikely to have been coincidence. Yeah. He wasn't scared. He was willing to accept a statistical ceiling above which he would say there's something more going on.
Yes, and I would agree. I would agree.
I mean, his beetle story is very interesting, you know, about the beetle that flies in through his window and lands on the desk just when he's got this guy on the couch and they're going through a dream he had about a beetle or something.
Interesting. I was just going to say, kind of rather ironically, all these scientific institutions and Oxford kind of Cambridge universities, etc., with all their skeptics and everything at the very, very higher levels in what we might call the Illuminati or elite levels, they're all doing occult rituals anyway, whether it's kind of like Freemasonic or other kind of secret societies, they are doing esoteric occult rituals. And yet these are the guys saying, oh, no, it's all a load of rubbish. You know, occultism doesn't exist.
Yes. Yeah. So they want the jam, but not giving it out to us, essentially.
Precisely. Really. Yeah. I've just noticed, Ben, that we've not covered anything to do with your hospital porter Illuminati. Oh.
Well, we can't cover everything, unfortunately. It's just two hours.
But what I was going to say is, Ben, would you come back at some point and maybe kind of cover those things that we've not covered?
Anytime, Andy. And it's been a great show. Really love being on the show.
Ben, can you just give some information about your own show and your website and any other activities that you might be doing soon?
If you want to find out more about me, Google HPANWO, Hospital Porters Against the New World Order. It'll take you to my website, the main site, and all. It's the portal to all the other sites, the news site, YouTube videos, my own radio show, my fiction, and much, much more. So there's plenty there to keep you occupied. It goes back many years, so there's an awful lot.
Brilliant. Lovely. Brilliant. Well, thank you very, very much indeed, Ben Emlyn-Jones, for taking part in our show tonight. And it just remains for me and Andy to say good night and join us again in February for our next show. Thanks very much, all. Good night.
Thanks very much. And log on to www.tunedinevents.co.uk for more events that I'm doing. Thanks, guys.
And you can listen to repeats of our show and download the podcast on Stitcher, iTunes, and I forget the other one, but there we go. And this is the Paranormal Peep Show on the Paranormal UK Radio Network. Good night.
See you later. Bye, guys.